Good morning, and a very big thank you to our choir for getting us off to such a beautiful, joyful start in our service this morning for Easter morning. What a lovely beginning, and lovely to see you all. Well, lovely to welcome you all, being a fifth Sunday, so beautifully planned for Easter morning. We're all together from our two churches, and lovely to be able to do that together today. And what a beautiful morning as well to come out in after so much rain. Beautiful, bright morning for Easter morning as we celebrate our risen Lord Jesus. So welcome to you all, and to those who are watching on the recording as well. Wherever you are most welcome, and blessings to you on this Easter day. We'll be following Easter celebrations through our service. I have one other notice to give, and that's just to let you know about this year's prayer room up at the Pitcairn Centre for Easter time. There was one there last year, and it's set up again this year with lots of creative different stations in the Donaldson room at the back in the Pitcairn. So if you have some time through the week, it's on until Friday, if you have some time, we would like to go and have a little quiet moment in prayer and do some of those creative activities relating to prayer and spending time in God's presence, you'll be most welcome. You can go along 10 until 12 any day through the week, because the Pitcairn is open then anyway. So you can enjoy that time then. It is open at other times as well, but you would need to book so that they open the centre for you. If you'd like to do that, please let me know, and I'll give you the details of how you can do that in the afternoon or evening. But just to let you know about that, if you'd like to be there through this week. But Liz has a few other announcements, and I'll invite her to bring those now.
The Guild meets in the hall tomorrow afternoon at 2 o'clock, when the speaker will be from the Collington Tunnel Project. There will be merchandise for sale, so if you're interested, ensure that you bring some cash with you. Anyone out with the Guild who feels that they would be interested in this project will be more than welcome to come along and join in. So that's tomorrow afternoon at 2 o'clock. There's a blanket over here which some of the ladies from the Knit and Natter have made, and we are raffling it for funds for the church restoration projects. And so if you would like to try and win it, you could purchase a ticket from it. Also, a wee note that George has come back with from the food bank, and sugar tinned food of mince, meatballs, etc. and that would be really grateful to have, because that's the things that they're really short on. And can I just say thanks to George for continuing to deliver all this stuff to the food bank. And our tea and toast morning will be held this Saturday in the hall from 10 till 12 noon. There'll be a small baking stall and a tombola. Any donations of home baking or tombola prizes, much appreciated, and as will any help from people who are able to give either on the day or Friday evening at 7 o'clock to set the hall up. And I've just got a wee thank you here from Graham. Graham says that he would just like to say thanks to all his friends at Cockpen for the many cards and good wishes for his big birthday. I'm not saying his age, but work it out, 3 score years and 10. He can't believe that he's still here as our organist since taking up the position when he first took up the position when he was 18 years old. So a lot of water has passed under the bridge in that time. So if you like to join with tea and coffee after the service, and joining fellowship, will be a piece of Graham's cake for you to have. And can also thank Wilma and Dot for doing the teas, Ian as always for setting them up, And yes, it's just much appreciated for everybody's help. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Liz. And we come to our call to worship, which is a fairly traditional one for Easter morning. And please join in the parts marked in bold on your order of service when we come to those. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Into our darkness dawns your light. Out of the grave your glory shines. Jesus, you meet us, risen Saviour, and we respond in delighted worship. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. And we continue in that spirit of praise with that wonderful Easter hymn, celebrating Jesus Christ risen today. We join to sing that hymn together.
Jesus, Christ, who is risen today, our Lord.
And we join hearts in prayer now. Let us pray together. Lord Jesus, with joy and praise, with awe and wonder, we come to you today, this Easter morning. We lift up our hearts and souls and voices to you, realizing afresh all you have done for us. Thank you for your abundant grace that has brought us forgiveness and fullness of new life through our faith in you. We rejoice in the wonder of this day, the good news at the heart of our faith, light after darkness, joy after sorrow, life after death. May the truth of the resurrection inspire us with new hope. May your triumph fill us with new joy. May the reality of your presence fill us with new faith. And so may we serve you with new inspiration. And all to your glory in the power of your name, as we join together in the words that you taught us to pray and saying together, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And we join to sing again our hymn, one of expressing love and life restored through our risen Lord Jesus in the hymn, Now the Green Blade Riseth. We join to sing.
Thank you. A reading from the Gospel of St. John. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went towards the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes.
But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned round and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? For whom are you looking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. Amen.
Thank you, John and Eleanor. We're going to enjoy the choir again now in the anthem, which is entitled "There's a Light Upon the Mountains" and arranged by our own Graham. Delighted to hear this.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord, we thank you this Easter morn as we come to your word and the powerful story of your rising and the resurrection that changed the world. Lord, may you lead us by your Spirit. Help us in our listening, help us in our responding together today. Thank you for your word, in Jesus' name. Amen. In our reflection this morning, I'm very grateful to Professor Tom Wright in his commentary, which I use so often, John for everyone, when coming to John's Gospel, for his thoughts that he brings on this passage that we're going to look at this morning, and also to the Engage Worship team for their Resurrection People resources prepared for this morning and for Easter Day. But let us go, if you will, back to the beginning of time, where there is darkness on the face of the deep. The formless beginning, the chaos, the void, the beginning. The wind and the world, God's breath, God's speech, summoning things never known before. Life and light, the first day, creation. In the beginning was the Word. And then, as we read at Christmas time, the Word became flesh. Jesus came as God with us, and he spoke, breathed, brought life and light. New creations spilled out around him wherever he went. But then Jesus died. Chaos comes again. Darkness descends on the little weeping group at the cross. Two men in the fading light do what has to be done to give Jesus a secure burial before the Sabbath begins. Then the long wait of the Sabbath for Jesus' followers in broken, bewildered chaos and darkness. And now, still in the darkness, the first day of the week, the new creation. Mary Magdalene comes to the tomb, but the stone is rolled away and the tomb is empty. At this stage, as she gives the news to Simon, Peter, and John, it seems as though chaos is added to chaos. Someone has taken Jesus away. But then there are strange things to see, as first John, then Peter run and reach the tomb. Someone has not only taken the body away, they have first gone to the trouble of unwrapping it. The linen cloths are lying there. Why on earth would you do that? And why is the single cloth from around Jesus' head lying neatly folded on its own? John had stayed outside at first, while Peter, so much like him, rushed straight into the tomb. But now John goes in too. And there seems to be something of an awakening that takes place in him. A wild delight at God's creative power. We're told he saw and believed. Believed that new creation had begun. Believed that the world would never be the same again. Believed that Jesus was alive again. And a little while later, on her own, back at the tomb, Mary Magdalene is given her own personal dramatic realization of that truth. Seeing through the tears of despondent grief, she is startled and then overjoyed to realize it is Jesus standing there before her as he says her name. The darkness and chaos are gone. New creation abounds. Jesus is alive. Death is defeated, and life, sheer life, life in all its fullness, as God has planned, can begin at last. And Mary and the disciples are part of this new creation as their new living, understanding faith in the risen Jesus is born. Jesus' resurrection is the beginning of God's restoration plan for everything he made, the making new of all creation. And Paul writes in Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 5, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old has gone, the new is here. As we put our faith and trust in Jesus, we have been raised with him as part of that new creation, seeking to live each day with and for him, and to serve and reach out to the world around us in his name. Easter is more than a day. Easter is the beginning of a whole new life with the risen Jesus. Do we have the joy of knowing ourselves part of God's new creation through our personal faith in Jesus and living a whole new life with the risen Jesus day by day? Sometimes we can get stuck in knowing about Jesus, but not fully delighting in him in our hearts and lives as Lord of our life. I was like that when I went up to university in St. Andrews. I'd grown up through the Sunday school and the youth fellowship at my home church in Edinburgh, and I knew all about Jesus, who he was, what he taught, what he'd done. But no one ever spoke to me about the step of committing my life to him as my Savior, Lord, and friend. That only happened when I went up to St. Andrews and I met Christians there and listened to them and watched them. I saw the love and light of Jesus shining from them, and I knew they were in a deeper place of faith than I was in. Through chats with my best friend, and she's still my best friend, a Christian lady, girl from Northern Ireland, she helped me understand the step of turning my faith into a living, active faith by asking Jesus into my life and committing my ways wholeheartedly to him, rather than having a more superficial awareness of Jesus and still going my own way in so much of my life. And so I quietly committed myself to Jesus midway through the second term of my first year. And it was a life-changing moment. In the time thereafter, I was filled with a whole new love for Jesus and a fresh joy and wonder in what he'd done for me in bringing me forgiveness and new life through his death and resurrection. I'd known about that and those facts, those details for so long, but suddenly it came alive and meant so much more in joy and wonder, in gratefulness and in love for him. I wonder if, do any of you remember the Christian singer-songwriter Adrian Snell? And this is going all the way back to the 1980s. Any of you remember Adrian Snell? Good. John remembers. But anyway, Adrian Snell was very much to the fore of the Christian music world back in the 1980s, and he wrote a wonderful series of songs telling the story of Easter, which is called The Passion. And some of you may know it. You can ring it up on YouTube later if you like, and particularly the last part, Jesus is alive. I did that yesterday, having not listened to it really for years and years, and it was just so great to hear it all again. It's so uplifting, and you might do well to listen to it on Easter Day and bless yourselves with his wonderful praise in that realization of Jesus being alive. But anyway, my best friend at St. Andrew's had a copy of The Passion, and I got my own copy of the record. It was records in those days, and I had my record player in my room. And that first Easter, having recently come to faith in Jesus, I played and played that record over and over again. There was just such a fresh sense of joy and wonder in celebrating Jesus, my risen Lord and Savior. And I wonder, have you found that joy in Jesus? Do you hold on to that joy and keep it fresh and alive? I'm going to lead us in a short prayer now as we come to the end of our reflection, and you might like to join in it. Whether you pray this prayer for the first time and have that sense of the Holy Spirit's leading and prompting this morning, of wanting to take that step of coming to personal living faith in Jesus this Easter day, realizing his love for you and all he's done for you, making you a new creation in him. Or whether you would like to make a recommitment to loving, following, serving Jesus in your life, let's join together in these words of prayer. God, I believe that you made me and you love me. I want to trust my life into your hands. Jesus, I believe you died for me on that first Good Friday. I trust that my old life of selfishness and sin died on the cross with you. The old has gone, the new has come. I believe that you rose to new life on Easter Sunday. You say that I am raised with you, a new creation, and that my life and my eternity is in your hands. Holy Spirit, as you raised Jesus from the dead, fill me now with that resurrection power. May I live for you in all I do, sharing your love with others, bringing your kingdom in this world until you come again. Amen. If you prayed that prayer for the first time this morning, finding a new joy in the Lord Jesus and his love for you, then do let me know afterwards. I'd love to know. Do please come and say. But just before we sing our next hymn, we're going to have a moment of continuing that celebration of new life that we know in the risen Lord Jesus. And we're going to do what we've done in the past years in taking daffodils, if you'd like to come out and do that, and we'll put them on the cross. The cross on Good Friday, such a symbol of death, but on Easter Day, it's empty, and so is the tomb. And so we celebrate new life, abundant new life, in Jesus risen and with us forever. And so in doing that, a little bit of a symbol of that and a visual of that, we'll decorate the cross with daffodils, bringing their beauty and color to bring the cross to life here. So if you'd like to do that in the next few moments in an orderly fashion, do come out. And there are baskets of daffodils beautifully prepared. I need to say thank you to Anne and Liz probably as well. Thank you so much for all the beautiful flowers again and bring the daffodils. So do come out, and there's chicken wire on the cross, so you can pop your daffodils in through the wire and we'll fill the cross with flowers. So let's do that now. Don't be shy. Thank you. Thank you for doing that. Doesn't it look beautiful? Transformed. That's great. Lovely. So we're going to sing again now, and we continue on that theme of giving thanks for the joy and hope and love that are restored in Jesus' rising again in our hymn, Christ is Alive, and the Universe Must Celebrate. Continue our worship now with our offering.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, there are no words deep enough to thank you for all your goodness, all your love, and your gift to us in Jesus our Lord. But we do want to express our thankfulness for all you have done for us. So we bring you now these gifts of money given here and in other ways, as a token of our love, a sign of our worship and desire to serve and follow you. Offered to you in joyful and grateful praise now, in Jesus' name, amen. And we continue in our prayers now, our prayers of thanksgiving and for others and ourselves. And as you will see on the screen there, if you'd like to join in a fairly repeated response as we go through the prayer, when I say Lord of life, you might wish to respond, hear our prayer. Let's pray. Loving God, we praise you for this day of celebration, this day of praise, this day of thanksgiving, a day that changes the way we think, the way we act, the way we live, that changes everything. Lord of life, hear our prayer. And so we pray now for change in our world, for change in all those places where there is human need. We pray for the poor and the homeless, the hungry and those who go without clean water. Lord of life, hear our prayer. We pray for the victims of war, for refugees, for divided communities and countries, remembering especially Ukraine, Israel and Gaza, Yemen, Sudan, Syria, and the Democratic Republic of Congo. Lord of life, hear our prayer. And we pray for the oppressed and those who are persecuted, imprisoned, and the exploited. Lord of life, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are ill at home, in care, or in hospital, and those who care for them, for those awaiting treatment, in the midst of treatment or recovering from treatment. Lord of life, hear our prayer. And we pray for the sorrowful, the fearful, the troubled in mind and heart. Lord of life, hear our prayer. Living God, may the truth of Easter break into each and every one of these situations, bringing help and healing, strength and support, comfort and courage, hope and help, faith and freedom, love and life, the change that only you can bring. Lord of life, hear our prayer. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And we come to the close of our service here. Do please stay, though, if you're able to join in tea and coffee and refreshments and fellowship together in sharing while we're here. But we join to sing our wonderful rousing closing hymn, again celebrating Jesus our Lord, thine be the glory, risen, conquering Son. We join to sing. are some words in our sending, if you'd like to join them, our words in bold. But God sends you out to be his resurrection people. Jesus, who was dead, is now alive. The old is gone, the new is here. And we are a new creation. God, send us out to be your resurrection people. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you all and remain with you now and evermore.